Diarrhea and vomiting is a common problem in children, very often caused by viral gastroenteritis, but it can be caused by bacterial gastroenteritis as well. So how are we going to manage this? Because make no mistake, this is a life-threatening condition in children. It's a very common cause of death, especially in young children. They lose fluids through diarrhea and vomiting, and of course, as they're losing fluids, they're also losing electrolytes. So how are we going to manage this? Well, the first and key message is that the mother should continue breastfeeding. Get all the breast milk into the baby or the child that the child will accept. Carry on breastfeeding, that's absolutely essential. That will give the child fluids, it will give the child nutrients, and it can also reduce the amount of diarrhea. So breast milk is very beneficial. And in fact, encourage fluids of pretty well all sorts. The only thing we really don't want to give are fizzy drinks, because if we give carbonated fizzy drinks, that can fill the stomach up and stretch the stomach and trigger the vomit reflex. So certainly don't give them fizzy drinks. But other than that, pretty well any drinks that the child likes. Now, the NICE guidelines in the UK recommend not giving fruit juice because it's acidic and it can cause further inflammation in the inflamed lining of the gastrointestinal tract. But the Facts for Life, published by the World Health Organization, say that you should give fruit juices. And I tend to go with the World Health Organization thinking, because children who have diarrhea and vomiting, as well as becoming dehydrated, often become hypokalemic. They lose potassium. And of course, that in itself is a life-threatening condition. So fruit juices will replenish some of the potassium, but certainly no fizzy drinks. But if the diarrhea persists at all, or even to give prophylactically is a good idea, oral rehydration salts are the key treatment. Now, oral rehydration salts are very simple. All you need is some clean water, some sugar and some salt, and that will make a very simple rehydration solution that you can make at home. More sophisticated commercial ones also contain potassium and some bicarbonate. And the key thing about oral rehydration solutions containing oral rehydration salts is that they massively increase the rate of absorption of fluids from the gut into the blood. I'm just going to show you how they work. Let's imagine we have the lumen of the intestine here. This could be the basement membrane with the endothelial cells on it. Individual cells lining, say, the duodenum. This might be the other side of the duodenum here. And these are the cells which comprise the mucosa. And this would be the lumen of the gastrointestinal tract here. And in the submucosa, we have many capillaries and blood vessels looping very near these cells. So blood is brought in via arterial vessels, goes through these capillaries, leaves via venous vessels. Now the key thing is, if there's just water in the gastrointestinal tract here, that will be absorbed into these cells. And from there, it will go through the mucosa into the submucosa, into the blood, therefore contribute to intravascular volume. But that happens relatively slowly. But if there's glucose in the solution, the glucose is taken into these cells here by active transport mechanisms. It doesn't just have to diffuse in. It's an active process. In other words, these cells lining the gastrointestinal tract are using energy to grab the glucose and to pull it in. And this happens quickly. It's active transport. So the glucose is actively transported across the membranes of the cells of the mucosa of the gut. It's grabbed and pulled in using enzymic ATP-powered mechanisms. So that means you get fairly high concentrations of glucose in the cells which line the mucosa very quickly. And of course, the glucose is an osmotic molecule, so that sucks the water in. So any water molecules that are here are sucked in very quickly via osmosis, because osmosis is a dilution effect. Osmosis waters down, So the water in the gut seeks to water down the relatively sugary cytosol in the cells which are lining the gastrointestinal tract. So the water moves very quickly, way, way more quickly than it would without the sugar being present. So that means that the water has got very small distance now to go to diffuse from the mucosa to the capillaries in the submucosa. So you can get fairly quick intravascular fluid resuscitation giving oral rehydration solutions, as long as they contain the sugar, glucose or sugar, both will have the same effect. And as well as that, we can put some salt in it, which replaces the salt, and if there's potassium in it, that also replaces the lost potassium. So oral rehydration salts really have been a major breakthrough in the treatment of gastroenteritis in children. If the child won't take the drinks, then you can consider giving a nasogastric ORS. But if you give it frequently, very small amounts, maybe feeding the child with a spoon, just small amounts but very frequently, then you can prevent the dehydration from developing, and even if it's developed, you can treat it because of this rapid absorption of the water because of the active transport of the glucose molecules. Now, if that's not working, if the child is getting worse, then we might need to think about intravenous therapy. And we would think about intravenous therapy when the child presents with so-called red flag symptoms, things that alert us to want to do something fairly quickly. And if the child was very poorly or deteriorating, we might take that as a red flag and go on to intravenous fluids. Or if the child had reduced responsiveness or reduced levels of consciousness, that's a red flag symptom. Or if the eyes are shrunken, that's a sign of dehydration. Or if the child's tachycardic, bearing in mind the normal heart rate for the child's age, of course, if it goes beyond that, if there's a tachycardia for the child, or a tachypnea, that's also a red flag symptom, rapid respiration. Another one that's worth keeping an eye on in children is skin turgor. If the skin loses its elasticity and the child's skin sort of puckers up a bit like an old person's skin, that means that the child might need to go on to intravenous therapy. But for most children, oral rehydration solutions containing oral rehydration salts are very often enough, thankfully. If they are in hospital care receiving intravenous fluids, we need to check the usual things. Sodium. We don't want the child to be hyponatremic. We don't want the sodium to be low. Potassium. Hypokalemia is a life-threatening feature. We also want to check the urea and creatinine to make sure that the renal function is adequate. And it's also worth checking glucose levels, because hypoglycemia is a complication of gastroenteritis in children, as well as the dehydration. Now, if the child will carry on eating during this period, then small amounts of food are probably a good idea. Mashed up food that the child likes. You might remember when you were ill as a child yourself, maybe your mum gave you some ice cream or something nice, something that's nice to eat that the child likes. Because continuing nutrition is very important. And then as soon as the child's better, we need to give them normal food and extra food to build them up. And the child is not fully recovered from the episode of gastroenteritis until their weight is back up to what it was before the child became ill.